Thank you very much. Next up, we're going to welcome Inna, who's going to talk to us about a different layer in our urban place.
Thank you, Elinruth. Can everybody hear me all right? Okay? All right, let me just do a timer. Okay. What kind of images come into your head when you hear the word extinction? What places when you think about biodiversity loss? I used to see images I saw on TV, a rainforest somewhere, a bird covered in oil, maybe a dead elephant filmed from above. But I think it's really, really important that we actually start understanding those things from our personal perspective and from our personal stories. And for me, it's the story of cotton. Main crop in my home country, Uzbekistan. My parents were sent each harvesting seasons when they were students during the Soviet Union. And spent a lot of time there, so a lot of their coming of age stories of love and like friendship takes place at the cotton, as they call it. And also culturally, tea drinking is a very important cultural thing in Uzbekistan. And as you can see, there is this icon of cotton on this very traditional tea set. But most of you also know what cotton did to Uzbekistan. Are you going to play? Of course not. It's a cool video of the RLC being dried out, but extensive watering of those cotton fields my parents worked on. One of the biggest environmental disasters, as we know. And for me, this is a perfect metaphor of what is happening worldwide. We have an abuse of resources that leads to extinction of several species in one place. But it also leaves the people who lived there and were fisher folk. They had to move away and they lost their livelihoods and their cultural identity. Okay, now you're playing. Cool. All right, but I actually own one of those cups. And while this image of cotton, when we think about how much suffering and violence it brought to my country, kind of could represent a hazardous material, but I love this cup. This is one of my favorite belongings because it holds childhood memories for me and also like a sense of some kind of cultural identity. And the thing is, we are so far in the ecological crisis that all of you have childhood memories or ideas of what your home country is connected to sites of ecological violence. Maybe for you it looks like this. Beautiful. Yeah? So nice. Ecologically speaking, this is as much of a desert as the one that the RLC left behind. Or this. This is actually created by a hydropower plant, main reason why eels are almost extinct in Sweden, and we have kind of an inbred situation with salmon. And this. Most forests we have in Sweden are plantations, and no matter what the forestry industry is telling you, they're not a sustainable business if we look from the biodiversity perspective. I'm Inna Zrajaeva, and I'm going to look into how cities can be maybe a good start of rethinking this troubled relationship we have with the non-human nature. Okay, so why are we so incredibly bad in this relationship with non-human nature? If I really summarize it super simply, two things. There has been this present idea that humans and nature, two different things, yeah? And also, we're two different things and one is much more important. Humans are on top and nature is somewhere there. Timothy Morton says, our scientific instruments tell us what old stories told us too, that humans and non-humans are deeply interconnected, but our ways of playing and our speech say something quite different. In my everyday life, when I have like a conversation with someone about like, what do you like to do in the free time? And they say, I like going to nature, you know? It's a place somewhere. It's like an amusement park. And then they see a silverfish in their apartment, freak out, completely kill the silverfish because it's like intruded their space. They're again clear, this is my space, this is not nature, nature is there. And you might think, who cares, a silverfish, whatever. When it starts to matter is when we understand how this relationship evolves over different layers. So this is a very personal layer. I don't think there should be a silverfish in my apartment. I have my plants that I invited them in. But if you look on a city scale, we're kind of similar, right? If you are non-human nature in a city, That means somebody bred you and brought you here, and you better behave within the margins that you're in. If you're a tree and you kind of have a friction with, let's say, a water pipe, who has to go? Yeah? So you either are kind of practical, and I think aesthetics, right? Singing birds can also be quite like seen as a use case. And if you're kind of a rogue non-human nature, right? Things that we kind of don't want to have here. You're a nuisance, a pest, something that should be removed, yeah, exterminated. And if we go a layer up again, country or global, we see this repeat again. There's a resource that we can either use to our disposal or maybe not. But it's definitely the dominance is established. And I think for me and for our initiative, Feral Malmö, we think the city is a good layer to try to kind of work with this relationship and heal this thing. Oh, cool. All right. And I also would love to talk to you about polyphonic assemblage as a way to understand how we can maybe better create relationship between humans and non-humans in cities. So it's a term established by anthropologist and my personal crush, intellectually, Anna Lowenhaupt Tsing. And she proposes to stop thinking of ecosystems. So here we have a picture from National Geographic. Yeah, this is an ecosystem. This fish eats this fish. There's a bird with a worm. They all do amazing things together. This is all a closed cycle. But she says that's not really how it is anymore. And we need to understand those things as human and non-human assemblages, again, to kind of bridge this separation. I have an example here that I made from my window. So it's not that great to see with my iPhone 6, but there are two seagulls here as a falafel stand. And I think they become an assemblage. So the seagulls, they kind of like, they chill there. They use the like urban infrastructure to kind of observe. And then if a human drops a falafel piece, they go and eat it. So the humans, the falafel stand, and the seagulls kind of become, and the traffic light become kind of an assemblage. And Tsing says that assemblages don't only are kind of open-ended gatherings, they also define life ways. So there are seagulls who are maybe the same species technically, right? But they chose a different life. They work like they're at the sea, they maybe do the traditional way of like fishing. But those are falafel seagulls. And they kind of, you know, they're different. Another example that I really love, this is a scooter, e-scooter in Nyhamnen. A lot of people really like throwing them in. And then this happens, blue mussels come and they kind of start living on them. And for me, that's also kind of an interesting assemblage, not only the blue mussel and the scooter, but also the person who throws them in, usually like human youth, and also the app that is behind it, right? You need the app to get the scooter to the water. That all becomes an assemblage. And there are already some people who kind of work in this way. There is animal-aided design, a German-based architecture firm. They kind of look at a whole life cycle, for example, of a sparrow. What does a sparrow need in the different times? What does it eat? Does it need places to hide? Sand bath? And then they renovate apartment buildings or sometimes whole neighborhoods and try to kind of put those things that the different species need. Another cool example is Urban Reef. They work with bioreceptive 3D printed material. And I really like their experiment with like water drains, where they have this bioreceptive material that kind of absorbs water and maybe could be like a thing where something can grow on, and not just a water drain. And a similar project, this is Gothenburg based actually, they also 3D print clay and put it in water for blue mussels. But my favorite example is not a cool design firm, but actually this guy. I hope we hear the sound and video plays.
I noticed there was a frog living in our fence, so I made him a house. But he hated it. Then 1 week later, but TikTok was like, he needs easier access. A patio that fills with water. We have really good ideas. So we started on V2, busted out these walls, added a patio, increased rivet amplification, and introduced additional arm comfort. Also, the people named him Frodrick. So we printed it, ripped off this garbage, and installed V2. And now it was cool.
Okay, it goes on like this. More frogs come, possums come. It like his whole fence becomes like an, you know, like a assemblage of different species. what I think is, I mean, it's like kind of like a naive and kind of endearing TikTok trend, but I think there's actually a lot of cool principles there as to look. So he really enters into a dialogue with the frog. So he kind of tries things out, the frog responds, then he does it again. Then it's very participatory, right? He has an audience and he kind of like asks them things and they give them stuff. And the audience is very engaged because he kind of realizes it and they also start creating a relationship with the frog. And the third thing that's very important for me is technology is present. Yeah, he uses like a camera, he uses 3D printers, but it's not, it's kind of not center stage. It's there, but it also could be maybe not there. And the relationship between the people in the community and between the frogs and the other animals, that becomes most important. And I think we really should focus on that when we talk about why cities. And what I'm missing is kind of, again, thinking about the layers. It kind of stays in a very individual, like they give them a name and it's cute and they, you know, that's great. But what is the situation of those frogs in the area where they live, right? Or on the country level, are they threatened or whatever? So that's something that's quite important. And when we as Feral Malmö did a workshop with Latinskola for the area of Nyhamnen, so basically kind of imagine like if the ocean could have a say in the Nyhamnen region, what would it be? We gave them profiles of a different Öresund species, and we wrote the profiles not like how you would write about a species in a biology book, but we also tried to understand the species on a political and cultural level. So an eel in Sweden is a very politicized species, no? Like a politician just lost his job because of an eel. Or for example, I don't know if you can see it, but this bristle worm, do you know what that is? No, right? And that's a political statement at all. Like it, there's not being represented, not being heard, being overlooked is very political as well. So yeah, the students came up with some ideas what Nyhamnen could look like. Let's go back to polyphonic assemblages and why it's called polyphonic. Tsing takes this term from polyphonic music. So we used to music where there's one melody, yeah? But in polyphonic music, you have several melodies at the same time, different actors having different rhythms. And she explains it that not only are the human and non-human assemblages, but there are different rhythms, you know? Things start to reproduce, things start to bloom, there's harvesting season, that's all is a rhythm. And actually, to explain it better to you, I found this really nice visualization of the double violin concerto from Bach. And it would be really nice if you maybe try to follow those different rhythms a bit and try to also understand how that can be different non-human actors and human actors in a city. So Bach made this a very harmonic piece. There's not so many voices also, but you can imagine if we have more of those voices, that there will be also a lot of dissonances. There will be friction. And an example that I'm going to show you is that's happening right now. Every year, that happens, yeah? It happens also outside here. They come to the town at the same time and start reproducing. This seagull picked a spot right outside a university entrance. And we know that they become quite protective when they are becoming parents. And that will, of course, resolve in friction. In urban space, if there's friction between humans and non-humans, that's very, very clear who's going to be the loser of the situation. So the next day I came back to the site, this happened. So there's, you know, eggs were removed, there's a cage, and then there were two gulls who I guess that's the parents, who were very upset and kind of cuddling with each other. Yeah. So if we don't choose violence to kind of navigate those frictional situations, we usually choose a way to kind of funnel the non-humans away. They have to kind of like go around. So like we build those crossings for reindeers, right? We take electric fence for elephants or those spikes for pigeons. But I think there's also a way that we learn to deal with this friction, how we also learn to deal with frictions in our personal relationships with our children, parents, partners. And also maybe give them sometimes the agency and space and take a step back. So there's this really nice example. This goose is not kidding around. I mean, yes, this goose has been a bit of an asshole, for sure. But also, I think it kind of proposes this opportunity, just take the other door. I mean, if there's a possibility, just go around. And from an interaction design perspective, that's my background, right? I think it's much easier to navigate humans in urban space than geese. I mean, sometimes it's just enough to put some lions on the ground and humans are just going to do perfectly what you want from them. Or in this country, you know, there's really a love for taking a number and staying in a line. Maybe we can use that to navigate those frictions better. But cards on a table, I mean, I want this big scale. I want traffic to stop when a certain species needs to migrate. But we're not going to let this happen, right? I mean, like, we can't even do like a Samagatan in Limham. If it would be for non-humans, maybe it would be even more problematic. But I have a hack for this. Actually, there is already a seasonal behavior where humans kind of block whole city streets. So those are two places where I used to live. It's Cologne and Rio de Janeiro during Carnival. And during Carnival, we block complete streets for days and everybody's on the streets and nobody's going to complain, even though, you know, people in Cologne can be definitely more annoying than seagulls during Carnival. So for me, it's kind of interesting how we can take those traditions and maybe, you know, adjust them in a way that we can better listen and adapt to those different rhythms of non-humans and navigate them. And actually, that's already a thing that have been done before. And we don't have to look far to find examples. So in North Germany, for example, if you have swallows in your house, it's really, really bad luck. You lose money if you remove the house of the swallows. So you will not touch it, right? I think we really need to start maybe adapting this more into our cities and how we design them. So with Feral Malmö, we run those workshops where we try to look in traditions that already involve non-humans. So for example, we drag a dead tree each year into our house, yeah, and then throw it away after a couple of days. And rethinking of how those can be changed to be more caring for the non-human species, but also for our communities. So the participants came up with this idea of having a neighborhood tree. So each neighborhood has maybe like a bigger tree and you gather around it. And maybe there's more tradition connected to, you know, a bigger community than just a family. We also hosted this locally alien festival just a couple of weeks ago, which again, we invited different creatives to explore relationship with non-human nature here in Malmö. And it was workshops, hands-on workshops, performances, and exhibitions. And the reason it's called locally alien is really also with this idea of, okay, why are we treating nature like aliens in our city? Who is alien and who is native in an environment that's completely constructed? But also, how can you call yourself local if you don't have any bond with the ecological community around you? And this brings me back to the cup. I have a quite scattered cultural identity. I'm a Russian Jew from Uzbekistan, which is a majority Muslim country. And then we moved to Germany and I moved in other places also. So for me, belonging can be quite a difficult thing. Where do I belong? So starting to create relationships to the ecology around me and kind of like binding it to some of my cultural identity. So this is it's a Russian or Slavic soup that mates with sorrel. I think there's something there. I think for me, it's a really, really strong act of active belonging, but also maybe a recipe. And this is a recipe book from my family, a recipe for maybe, you know, rethinking our cities in order to heal culturally, but also ecologically. Thank you.